The following program is brought to you by Caltech.
Thanks a lot, Michelle. And let me first, before I get started introducing or harassing Markus here, I wanted to acknowledge there's three team leads on this KISS study. And the KISS study is this Keck Institute for Space Sciences. And studies, thank you. I thought I was looking at you to get it right. I was like, I know, was it Kathleen? No, exactly, yeah, okay. We've had some issues with the name. Maybe both Barris and Jeff Shapiro can stand up and show everybody. So, Jeff is from MIT and is an expert in all things quantum communication, and Barris is at JPL. And I can tell you that this meeting just would not happen without Barris. He's been the engine behind it, at least from my perspective, perspective there. So let's thank Barris for all this. So Markus, okay. So Markus and I have been working together for a number of years, and it's always hugely fun. You're gonna find out that this Austrian accent that he has will convince you that anything is possible and that you're willing to go for something with extreme enthusiasm just by the language. Markus is Bavarian, and he got his PhD in 2002 in Munich. And if you look at his CV and if you actually sit down and have beers with Markus, you're gonna find out that his early studies were a combination of physics and philosophy. So there's, and that philosophical, education is not just for at home reading or vacations. It actually comes deeply into the physics and the physics approach that Markus has here in his work. In 2003 through 2006, if I got the dates right, he worked with Anton Zeilinger's group, and it was on the quantum cryptography, quantum information, all these sorts of things. In 2006, you transitioned to a senior scientist at the Institute for Quantum Optics and Quantum Information, again in Vienna. And then in 2009, Markus started his own group as a professor of physics at Vienna and has an extremely active group there. He's awarded a number of prizes. In 2007, he was awarded the Fresnel Prize from the Europhysics Society. In 2007, the... my handwriting is bad. The Leibniz Prize from the Austrian Academy of Sciences. 2008, the Kohlravish Prize. Is that right?
Kohlravish
Prize. Yeah. So that one. Yeah. And then in 2010, the Bessel Research Award from the Humboldt Foundation. So, like I said, Markus is an expert in all things quantum information, quantum cryptography, foundations of quantum physics. And the way that we interact mostly is on looking at mechanical systems and trying to get them down to quantum limits. And Markus now has collaborations not only with my group, but also with Oscar Painter's group on campus. And so his kind of footprint is growing and is everywhere. So anyway, let's take a moment to welcome Markus and really look forward to watching. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much for this flattering introduction. The only correction, the accent, of course, is Bavarian, as you will recognize in a second. I also would like to thank very much the organizers for having me for actually organizing this beautiful workshop here at the Keck Institute and got it. So, what this talk is going to be about is, it's somehow related to the title. But what I wanted to tell you is, I want to give you a few examples how questions on the very foundations of quantum physics have been turned into experiments, or actually are right now being turned into experiments. And that putting such experiments in a space environment, or at least thinking about putting such experiments in a space environment, can really give you access to a completely new parameter regimes. And therefore, potentially, hopefully, this is actually what we are discussing right now, the last few days, access to beautiful new experiments in new physics. So the examples that I chose is follow three simple questions about quantum physics. The first simple question is, why the quantum? So what does the wave function mean? We actually go from EPR to up to quantum cryptography. The second one, why the classical? So why do we actually have a classical world? What is the relation between the quantum world and the classical world? And finally, what is the connection between quantum physics and gravity? You see, these are three very simple questions. And I will show you now that thinking about those can actually lead to some beautiful insights. So let's start with the first one. Since this is a very mixed audience, I apologize to the trained quantum physicist. I would like to start introducing a couple of fundamental concepts of quantum physics. And the two basic ones that I would like to introduce you to are based on two challenges, conceptual challenges that quantum physics poses to us. The first one is the one of randomness. So suppose we have somewhere the ability to create single photons. I push a knob, a single photon, so a single particle of light is created, falls on this this beam splitter, and normally this, such a beam splitter is just a half-silvered mirror, so when light shines on such a beam splitter, half of the intensity of my laser beam is reflected here into B, the other one is transmitted. If a single photon hits such a beam splitter, then you may ask what's happening. It's a single particle, so I can tell you the particle doesn't get split, so it stays one particle, and what's going to happen is that you will have a click in one of those two output ports, let's say in the upper one here, with 50% probability. And if you look at the lower one, you will also get a click with 50% probability. Now you may say, well, okay, that's of course I have now this very successful quantum theory, and if I ask quantum theory, if I click here my single photon source, what do I expect? At which of these two outputs am I going to find the photon? And quantum theory is going to predict you, well, you're going to find a photon here with 50% probability. So this is something that is intrinsically built into quantum theory. Quantum theory won't provide you with an answer to the question which way this the photon really went, but it will only tell you probabilities for individual measurement outcomes. Okay, and we call that objective randomness because the theory does not provide you with a more detailed prediction of what's going on. Now, if you, and that's actually something that Einstein realized very early on, back in 1917, in a beautiful paper about actually spontaneous and stimulated emission, he realizes that and says the weakness of the theory, of quantum theory, that is, lies in the fact that time and direction of the elementary process, in that case, the single photon actually hitting the beam splitter, is left to chance. Okay. And the end of the paper, by the way, he also writes, and I'm pretty sure that after some time, a more intelligent person is going to come and will actually get rid of these mathematical deficiencies and will come up with something that works better. Right? So this was 1917, so 95 years ago. Nothing happened since then. So the second challenge is related to that one. Instead of putting a detector here, let's assume we just recombine those two possible paths of the photon and ask, well, what is the probability that the photon detector clicks here? Okay. And the naive way of answering this question would be, well, if the photon goes the upper way, and we saw that it went one of the two ways because the detector clicked, for example, in A with 50% probability. So if the photon took the way A, well, then it arrives at the second beam splitter, and we know what happens with a single photon at a beam splitter. With 50% probability, it will end up in one of the two arms. You can argue the same way for the lower path. Well, if it goes in that direction as a beam splitter, and it turns out that you will say, because of our previous experiment, with 50% probability, it will end up in one of those two arms. So if you sum that up, it means our prediction, our naive prediction of this experiment would be with 50% probability one of those detectors is going to click. If we do the experiment, turns out this is not the case. If the two paths here are equally long, we know interference occurs because of quantum theory telling us this strange superposition of the two possibilities of the paths, and with 100% probability, this detector is going to click. That means that the outcome of this experiment is in direct conflict with the assumption that the photon went either this way or that way. So which way did the photon go? This is the second challenge of quantum theory. Well, the answer of quantum theory is A plus B. Okay? Quantum physicists are lazy people, and normally they say, well, that means the photon went both ways. That's simply not true. What it really means is, when quantum physicists say the photon went both ways, what they mean is the outcome of my experiment is in conflict with the assumption that it went either this way or that way. Okay? It's just a short way of saying that, the photon went both ways. But we know what we mean when we say it. So eventually, it's just a short way of rephrasing that. So these are our challenges in quantum physics. We have individual measurement outcomes which do not have a more fundamental explanation. Probabilities are fundamentally built in into quantum theory, and we do have a situation that really challenges our intuition about the physical world. We have a situation where we know the input, so the skier riding towards the tree, we know the output, we get a result, but if we try to understand in our classical terms what happened in between, we arrive at extremely strange views of the world. Okay? So these are basically the two challenges that make up quantum theory. And this is something that from the very beginning on bothered the founding fathers of quantum theory. Can we go beyond this fact that we do have probabilistic predictions for individual events? Can it be that we have a more fundamental theory where quantum theory is just a boundary case and like statistical theory versus thermodynamics? Right? And Einstein was one of the scientists who really thought a lot about that. And this question was the origin of this very famous paper by Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen in 1935. Posing the question if the quantum mechanical description of physical reality can be considered complete. Okay? So that actually, couldn't it be that there is a more underlying theory that would provide us with an answer to the question, which way did the particle actually go? It's a very beautiful paper, I recommend everyone to read it. The New York Times also got a copy of the paper, so it made it on the front page of the New York Times just a day before the paper came out. Einstein was furious because he actually didn't like this communication with the press. So you see, Einstein attacks quantum theory, scientist and two colleagues find it is not complete even though correct. Well, so... the bottom line of this paper, I don't walk you through it, but I just tell you the bottom line is that they actually say, so they think that what they have shown is that the wave function does not provide a complete description of the physical reality, okay, which is correct, because we just saw that, and we left open the question of whether or not such a description exists. We believe, however, this is the famous final sentence of this paper, that such a theory is possible. Okay. Before I tell you the solution to that, I introduce you to the notion of entanglement. Schrödinger was the one who coined this term, and entanglement is essentially, you see again, we have here the plus. Entanglement is essentially a superposition, not of A and B, but of correlations between two systems. Okay? Instead of having now two paths where we have a superposition between them, we now have correlations of two systems, and now we have a correlation, a superposition of the correlations of these two systems, with very interesting consequences. If we can create such an entangled state, it means that the only knowledge that we have about two particles being entangled is about the correlations of the systems. So they can both be either, let's say, zero, which means, for example, both have black hair, or they can be one, so both have red hair. Okay? If this is the complete description of our system. This doesn't provide us with any information about the individual particle. So we cannot, even in principle, know before measuring the system, the particle, which color it actually has, whether it's 0 or 1. Only the measurement will determine the color. And once we have measured one, we know immediately, because of the correlations here, what the other one has. So this is sort of the phenomenology of entanglement. A very funny side note. If you read, so this Schrödinger introduced that in 35 in a very beautiful paper, and today we use it as a technical term. But if you read the paper where he introduces it, this term emerges, so to speak. It's really beautiful, where he in the first parts of the paper he talks about entanglement of predictions, okay, and then later on he talks about entanglement of our knowledge. He just tries to describe the situation that you have when two particles are combined together in this strange quantum mechanical way. And then later on he says, well, the psi functions are tangled up, okay? The expectation catalogs, they are mixed with each other. And only in the very last part of the paper, he just talks about entanglement as a technical term. So it's a very beautiful example how technical terms are introduced into physics when you simply try to introduce a new concept. Okay, now, so entanglement was also used by Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen in their paper with the simple argument, well, look, if I have such an entangled system, I measure one property, let's say this property, whatever, I measure the property 0 or 1, and I get a result, and from that I can actually infer the property of the other system. But I can also measure on a complementary basis, 0 plus 1. This would also be perfectly correlated, but it is a complementary property that, according to quantum theory, I cannot know with the same precision as the with arbitrary precision at the same time to my property 0 or 1. And by that simple argument, that because using this entangled state by measuring one system, I can always infer either one or the complementary property of the other system, he concludes, well, that means that these properties have to have existed beforehand. And that means that entanglement shows that quantum theory is actually an incomplete description of physical reality. Enters John Bell in 1964. And the main message of John Bell is, well, what Einstein wrote is fully correct, okay? The quantum physical description of the quantum mechanical description of physical reality is incomplete. The point is, it cannot be completed. Okay? If you try to come up with a more complete theory that is based on the assumption, the joint assumption of locality, in the sense of Einstein locality, and of realism, in the sense that measurement outcomes are predetermined by properties that the system has before the measurement, then there is no way that you can come up with a more complete physical theory that would describe all quantum physical phenomena. Okay? And this is what he put into Bell's theorem. The essence of Bell's theorem is, if you have such an entangled state of two particles, and you distribute it to Alice and Bob, and you start making measurements on this here at Alice and at Bob. So you try to measure, as I said, so you try to measure property 0 or 1 or 0 plus 1 and so on, and then you compare with the measurement results that Bob got, who also can choose between different measurement settings. And you build up correlations between your measurement outcomes. Then it turns out any possible theory that is based on this joint assumption of local realism actually results in an upper bound on the possible correlations that you can measure between Alice and Bob. Turns out, if you have an entangled source, if your particles are entangled, then quantum theory tells you you can violate this bound by a factor of square root of 2. Okay? So that tells you that quantum theory, that the correlations that are due to quantum theory cannot be explained by any theory that is based on a joint assumption of locality and realism. Okay? So this is the main message of Bell's theorem. Quantum mechanical description of physical reality is incomplete, yes, but it cannot be completed based on the joint assumptions of locality and realism. That's the message. And of course now, once the theorem was out, and there have been follow-up theorems by Bell, Klauser-Horn, Klauser-Horn, Chimney-Holtz, then later on by Greenberger, Horn, and Zeilinger, who actually showed that the assumption of elements of physical reality for a three-particle state is in contradiction with quantum theory. So now you had all those theorems out, in 64 Bell's theorem, and the question was now, well, if you measure actually the correlations between such an entangled state, well, maybe quantum theory doesn't hold, okay? So maybe it is the case, if you measure those correlations, actually we will find a value that is smaller than 2. Okay, so this was still in the realm of possibility. And therefore, people started to build up experiments that try to test this inequalities of these assumptions. Okay, what I put here, I almost forgot that. So just to make it very clear what it means, this local realism. It means you cannot think of your particles that go to Alice and to Bob as having their properties somehow with them in suitcases, okay? And the detector is just like a border control, please open your suitcase, and I read it out, okay? So this way of thinking simply doesn't work, okay? This is the very essence of Bell's theorem. Forget about thinking of entangled states in that way. Okay, so then there was a series of Bell experiments. I only go very briefly over that. The very first one was conducted by Stuart Friedman and John Clauser, and they eventually didn't see any deviation from quantum theory. Of course, if you want to test really this assumption of local realism, your experiment has to fulfill certain boundary conditions in order for loopholes, which means possible theories based on local realism that can still sneak in because the experiment was not performed carefully enough. And therefore, so this experiment had still many loopholes open. For example, the polarizers were set in a fixed fashion. So that means, in principle, the source at the point of emission could have already known what the polarization correlation here is. And in principle, you could come up now with a theory that, with the prior knowledge of the polarization correlators, could have produced the results of the violation of a Bell inequality, and so on and so on. So there are many loopholes. We don't have the time to go into all the details, but there are many other experiments that have been performed later on that successively started to close all these loopholes. So, for example, there were experiments by Aspelmeyer and by the Zeilinger group, Gregor Weiss et al. That actually started to close, for example, this locality loophole. Then there's a so-called randomness loophole, and so on. But the thing that I would like to point out is that in order to, for example, close the locality loophole, it's already important that you start to increase the distance between the sources, because the point is you should switch, you should choose your settings here between Alice and Bob in space-like separated regions. So that means, when the photon arrives here, you should make a choice and make a setting here, and these settings and the choice should have been made space-like separated, such that no information whatsoever could have arrived prior to the measurement here in no reference frame. Okay, so this is the point, and therefore you have to actually, because switching takes some time, and therefore you have to separate your sources to a far distance. And here's one of the latest experiments by the Zeilinger group, where they actually closed the so-called freedom of choice loophole, where they were also, not only the setting of the polarizer was space-like separated from the setting of the other one, but also the choice that is made to choose the setting, to set the polarizer, is space-like separated from the other side. And for that reason, they did this experiment between the two Canary Islands, between La Palma and Tenerife. So they had an entangled photon source here in La Palma. Where was that one? That was actually in La Palma, the entangled photon source. This is based on spontaneous parametric down conversion. And the entanglement was then distributed via telescopes So one photon was kept locally at La Palma, the other one was sent through a telescope to Tenerife. Tenerife, there's an optical ground station of the European Space Agency where they actually collected the photon and then they measured the correlation. And if you look at the basically space diagrams where these measurements and the choice of the measurements have been taking place, you can see that the settings were chosen independently from the from each other. So this was the freedom of choice loophole. In the future, and that brings me now to even longer distances, of course, what one definitely needs to do is no experiment has been performed so far where all loopholes have been closed simultaneously. I mean, nature would be very vicious, of course, malicious, if really for each experiment it would choose a different loophole to trying to ruin your experiment, but nevertheless, it's certainly an important experiment to close all of them at the same time. So there's another one talking about photons here, is the so-called detection loophole. This has been closed, for example, with entangled massive particles, like entangled ions, entangled superconducting circuits, and so on. So here, detection you can do with 100% efficiency. In the photon case, it turns out, in order to exclude the possibility that a sub-ensemble of your particles that is not detected would actually be able to still obey local real to complete a locally realistic description, if you would be able to observe the full ensemble, you need a certain threshold in your detection probability, and that is on the order of 70-80%. And this is what people are working on right now for the photonic case. And for the atom case, people are trying to distribute entangled atoms over large distances and then using the detection efficiency of the atom. So there's a lot of things going on. This would be basically a separate talk. The reason why I'm telling you all this story is because all these experiments were motivated by very deep fundamental questions about the underlying nature of physical reality. Okay, so is there a possibility that locally realistic description can be maintained, or do we really need a completely new understanding and give up either locality or realism to understand our physical world? At the same time, with these developments, something else happened. And what you see here is actually the number of citations of the EPR paper versus time. Okay. So the first one is 1935 to 1944. Okay, so essentially these are basically reply by Bohr to the paper and some other people. So you see like 10 or 15 papers. So between 1935 and 1970, so like 40 years, nothing happens at all. Right? Then the first Bell experiments come, and then you see something happens. Some new ideas pop up. And it turns out that based on these ideas of entanglement and the impossibility, so the objective randomness of quantum theory, ideas like quantum cryptography popped up, quantum teleportation, and so on and so on. Ideas that you can actually store information in a quantum system and then use the quantum properties to process information. And this is this whole era of quantum information that we are now in that results in these ideas of quantum computing and so on and so on. And what I would like to very briefly just show you is the idea of quantum cryptography. It's a beautiful idea based on... So here I just focus on the idea based on entanglement that has been put forward by Arthur Eckert in 91. You have an entangled source, you distribute it between Alice and Bob, and I told you that the property of the individual particle is completely random, right? So you cannot know it in principle. So measurement here, in that case it's polarization entangled photons, of the polarization locally will result in a perfectly random sequence of outcomes, right? Because of this feature of objective randomness of quantum theory. So you have locally now perfect random sequence, but if Bob on the other side actually measures the very same property than Alice, then his outcome will be perfectly correlated with the outcome of Alice. So what you have now, if both happen to measure in the same basis, is you will have random sequence locally, but perfect correlations. I mean, this is just the perfect starting condition to share a secret message. Okay, you have a random key, and now you can start to share a secret. And well, there are of course many, many things to say here, how this is really implemented and so on. But I think the main idea is very clear and immediately very, very simple to understand. And actually, other proposals than Bennett and Brassard in 92, the very first experimental realizations basically go back to the groups of Zeilinger, of Quiat, and Chizin in 2000. Okay, why am I telling you that? Well, because I was trying to motivate a little bit the interest of space science in these questions. It turns out quantum cryptography is something that really raised extreme interest and is still being pursued very actively. There are companies coming up. There are here's one example of one of many local networks that are right now being set up and are tested all around the world. And the question that you may ask is, well, what about global quantum key distribution? How could I do that? This is these are fiber links here. You see the distances are on the order of like 10, 20, 30, maybe 50 kilometer. But how do I connect, I don't know, the US with Europe? Fiber link won't do. It simply doesn't work. So the idea came up of using something like space-based quantum communication. And in order to do that, the question is, well, can we do all of that in free space? Can we distribute single photons and tangled photons via free space and eventually go up a satellite and start distributing that and use that for quantum communication? And this sparked a whole series of very, very beautiful experiments. Here's one by Richard Hughes and Beth Nordholt and colleagues, where they actually demonstrate free space quantum key distribution over 10 kilometers and in daylight. I didn't find a better picture, Richard, but this is actually an on-site picture that was made. This was sort of the truck where they had all the experiments in and demonstrated this free space key distribution. Another experiment, this took place a little bit more early at the in the Bavarian Alps by the Weinfurter group and together with John Rarity, and this continued. So at some point in 2008, we performed an experiment where we reflected a photon, reflected a pulse from a corner cube satellite, and actually the attenuation was such that on average only a single photon was reflected back in the field of view. So it was sort of simulating a single photon link between a satellite and a ground station. Then there was the demonstration of distribution of quantum entanglement via free space, and only recently these papers are like a month old or so in the archive, demonstrating quantum teleportation over 100 and 144 kilometers. So sort of this is the jump between 2003 and 2012. So all these developments have now led really in the possibilities of free space quantum communication. The very early ideas date back to 98, I think, again to Richard and Beth, and this all has led now to developments that are taking place right now. So here's an example of an entangled photon source that is developed at this very moment in a collaboration between the Vienna Institute for Quantum Optics and some other European institutions and some space agencies, where they try to actually fabricate a space-qualified entangled photon source. You see, the challenges are, of course, quite demanding, because you need to go from a breadboard down to something that goes in this little space, has only a few kilos of mass, and so on. But this is on the way, and this is quite exciting developments. Just to give you a very brief overview of what is being done right now, all over the world there are different projects that are being started, and people try to go in, for example, Vienna is leading an effort to put an entangled photon source to the International Space Station. Canada has some ongoing efforts. China has a mission that is approved and launched, the launch is foreseen in 2016. Japan has a little mission where they actually try to launch something by 2013. Singapore wants to test an entangled photon source also quite soon. So there are many things happening right now, and it's just very exciting times to see that. And I think the bottom line from that is that within the next 5 or 10 years, we will have shown that we can have quantum entanglement in space. And then I guess the big question is, beyond quantum cryptography, what can we learn about the underlying nature, the fundamental nature of quantum physics? And I think this is going to be a nice example where then just an advanced technology will lead to the possibility of answering new questions that you previously simply haven't thought about. Right? This is an enabling technology, and it is going to enable, I'm pretty sure about that, it is going to enable simply new fundamental questions. We just need to think about that. This is just for completeness. Only a few days ago, the Canadian consortium put on the archive actually a paper with a long list of possible tests that one might be able to do with an entangled photon source, a single photon source on a satellite. And I won't read that to you. We don't have time. I would like to go on. I think this just underlines what I just said. So once we have the source, people think hard. And once you think hard, simply new ideas pop up. Okay. So part two, why the classical? This is a super interesting question. And one of the nice things about being in Vienna is that I'm on the fourth floor. And on the fourth floor also there's the library of the university, of the physics department of the University of Vienna. And the library also has with it the Schrödinger archive. So you can go there and you can actually browse through the letters and so on of Schrödinger. And when you do that, you find a very interesting letter that dates back to August 35. So this was after the EPR paper. It's August 35, it's Albert Einstein to Erwin Schrödinger. Old Lyme, so Einstein was already in the US and trying to bring Schrödinger to Princeton. So basically all of the letters had this purpose. This letter had also another purpose. So Einstein writes, "Dear Schrödinger, you are in fact the only human with whom I really like to discuss." And then there's some other stuff. And then, although in our expectations of where to go, we are the strongest antipodes. Okay, and what does he mean? Well, he means the interpretation of quantum physics, interpretation of the wave function. What does the wave function mean? And here comes the funny twist to the story. The reason why Einstein wrote this letter was to convince Schrödinger that his view, so Schrödinger's view of the wave function, was too realistic. Okay? So this was the purpose of the letter. So Einstein came up with an example. He told him, look, your view of the wave function is way too realistic. If you really think that the wave function describes reality in that way, then you bump into the following problem. And here's the problem. Don't be afraid, I read it to you. Okay? He says, take the following example. You take a system, a substance, he says, in a chemically metastable equilibrium. A chunk of gunpowder, which can inflame itself via inner forces. Okay? And the average lifetime is on the order of a year. In the beginning, the psi function characterizes this state via a sufficiently well-defined macroscopic state. Your equation, he writes to Schrödinger, your equation, however, takes care that after a year or so, this is not any longer the case. After a year, the psi function describes a sort of mixture between being exploded and not yet exploded system. Okay. By no art of interpretation can this psi function be made an adequate description of the real factual situation, because in reality, there is no such thing between exploded and not yet exploded. Okay? We all know where this example leads to. This example leads to the famous Schrödinger cat. Here's the quantum optical version of Schrödinger's cat. We take again our single photon source, we have the beam splitter, and we know that after the beam splitter, the photon is in a sort of, remember, A plus B, okay? So we don't know what. And quantum theory takes care that after the interaction with the beam splitter, we create this entangled state, which contains a cat which is alive and a cat which is less alive. Yeah? So the point of this is that quantum theory allows for superpositions of macroscopically distinct states. Yeah? No matter in what this macroscopic distinction, how this macroscopic distinction is realized. Whether this is a cat being in two really macroscopically distinct states of alive or dead, or of a massive object being here or there, right? With really macroscopic separation in between, such that I can, with my own senses, see that there's a difference. So can that be true? This has some very deep consequences, of course, to such macroscopically distinct states, because in a way we always believe that such states are realized in nature. But when we say are realized in nature, exist, we always really mean that there's no way that we can invert them. So there's a sort of irreversibility in that. And what that essentially tells you is that irreversibility is something that simply doesn't exist as a concept in quantum theory for none state whatsoever. So the way that we are going in looking in this direction is how can we really have macroscopically distinct systems and have large systems is we started thinking about mechanical systems. So Keith already pointed that out in the introduction. So can we create superpositions of, for example, center of mass states of large macroscopic resonators or of, let's say, spheres that are separated that are in a superposition of being in here or in this location. This requires that you can place such massive mechanical systems somehow into quantum states. And during the last, say, 6-7 years or so, this really took off. This whole attempt to create such quantum states. So here are just some examples, right? Mechanical systems coupled to charge quantum systems, okay? Mechanical systems coupled to spin quantum systems. Mechanical systems coupled to photons. There are many examples in the literature that you find right now, like here at Caltech, an experiment by Matt LaHaye and by Keith and my group is coupling a mechanical system to a superconducting Cooper pair box. Another one from Delft, I think, coupling carbon nanotubes with single electrons, coupling Andrew Cleland and John Martinez at UCSB, coupling a superconducting phase qubit to a mechanical system. Spin, right? Dan Rugard with his very famous MRFM methods. So it's resonant force microscopy. Then recently coupling NV centers to mechanical systems. And also with photons, there are a couple of works where we demonstrated that you can strongly couple photons to mechanical systems. So bottom line is, because you can functionalize mechanical systems, so you just put something on them, like a mirror you couple to light, something on ducting you couple to charge, a magnet you couple to spin, and so on, these systems really enable a whole range of possible ways to put them into the quantum regime. Let me very briefly just mention the idea how we, using light, try to push these things and operate center of mass states of those systems in a quantum machine. The main idea is very simple. You utilize radiation pressure inside optical cavities. That is something that is well known here at Caltech. We have here LIGO going on. So if you have a cavity and you have light in there, then you have radiation pressure. So the point is, if you have a cavity with a moving boundary, for example, then the mechanical motion directly couples to your frequency of the cavity. And this is immediately the direct optomechanical coupling interaction. Okay. So what you have is, as intrinsic interactions, two things. Number one, you have an intrinsic optical nonlinearity. So if you have a beam of light that couples resonantly into your cavity, you shift, just due to radiation pressure, your mechanical system. So you shift the cavity length, but now the light is reflected from a different position, so you collect a phase shift. And the more light you put in, the larger is the phase shift. So what you have now is you have an intensity dependent phase shift of the light that comes out of your optomechanical system. And this is an optical nonlinearity. That's a Kerr medium. Okay? So this thing acts as a Kerr medium for light. At the same time, if you detune the light that pumps the cavity, what happens is now that the mechanical motion starts to modulate the intra-cavity amplitude. What does that mean? Well, you modulate the radiation pressure on your system. And when you have an harmonic oscillator and you start to introduce a position-dependent force, what you change is the spring constant of the system. Okay? So just by pumping your system now detuned with respect to the cavity frequency, you change the spring constant of your mechanical system. And because of the fact that the cavity has a finite lifetime, this force that acts position-dependent is retarded in time, which means that you don't only have a position-dependent force, but you also have a momentum-dependent force. So you not only change the spring constant, but you also change the damping. And now what you have suddenly is you have full control over the mechanical susceptibility, so both the real part and imaginary part. That's all you need. We can now, we have nonlinear control over the light, we have full control of the mechanical susceptibility because of this optomechanical coupling. And Braginsky was the first one to point that out already in the 70s, did some experiments with microwaves in the 80s, Dorsel, Mestre, and Walter did the very first optics experiments in this direction, and many others followed. I give you in 1 minute the quantum picture of that. What I just told you is you have a cavity with a moving mechanical system. So here is your cavity frequency, and let's assume you pump your cavity, okay? So not single photons, really pump it hard, such that you can linearize the interaction, and you operate in a regime where your cavity line width is small with respect to your mechanical frequency. If you pump the cavity now, rapidly tuned at lower frequencies, the only way to scatter photons inside the cavity is by getting some extra energy. The energy that the system takes from the mechanics. Okay? So what you have now is you have coherent energy exchange between the cavity photons and the mechanics. And in two-mode quantum optics, this is known as a beam splitter interaction, okay? Coherent energy exchange. If you pump on the blue side, the only way to scatter photons into the cavity is by putting some extra energy into the mechanics. Okay? That means you create joint excitations between the cavity field and the mechanics. In two-mode quantum optics, again, this is known as a two-mode squeezing interaction. So what we have now is, taking all of that together, we have now a method to obtain full quantum optical control via the beam splitting interaction and the two-mode squeezing interaction over the mechanical system, just by using quantum states of light. This is beautiful. Now we have everything. Okay? You can even introduce some nonlinearities by doing single photon counting, blah, blah, blah. Okay, just play all these wonderful tricks of two-mode quantum optics. This is just equivalent. You only replace now one optical mode by a mechanical mode, and you can actually put such a massive mechanical system into the quantum regime. This is really wonderful. Of course, there are a couple of boundary conditions in order to play all these tricks and apply all those beautiful quantum operations. You want your mechanical system to be already in some sort of pure state. Because if you apply some unit operations to mixed states, well, it's still mixed states and you won't see anything quantum. So what you need is you need to start to prepare some minimum entropy states. So you need to, basically just laser cool your system down to the ground state, okay? And this you can easily do because this is the way to do it, no? Your beam splitter interaction. You pump your system. If the cavity decay rate is large, the photons that you just scattered into the cavity that took away a mechanical phonon energy leave the cavity immediately and take away the energy. And that's sideband resolved laser cooling. This has been done with ions ever since, and this is how the normal mode motion of an ion chain is cooled down to the quantum ground state. And this is why they can do trapped ion quantum computing. And on the other hand, of course, if you then have prepared your system in the ground state, then you can start cranking up the interaction strength and do all the fancy physics. Since I'm running out of time, I just give you the overview and won't go into the details. So you see many groups around the world have started this endeavor. So here's phonon number versus sideband resolution. And the main message of this slide is here that these points close to the quantum ground state have all been realized last year. Right? So that means that sort of this whole field emerged quasi-instantaneously around 2004, 2005. And now in 2011, also almost simultaneously, all the groups are now with different methods prepared the systems into the quantum ground state. Maybe just to point out one example, this is the collaboration that Keith already mentioned. Recently, the Painter group actually managed to cool the mechanical motion of such a photonic crystal cavity down to the quantum ground state. We were partly involved in that, but the main work was really done here at Caltech. And the main idea here is what you have is a photonic crystal cavity. So this is like a Fabry-Perot resonator, but just on a nanomechanical beam. And you see that in that case, now the mechanical motion of this nanomechanical beam modulates the cavity frequency, and there you have your optomechanical coupling. And what you do now is, by using an optical taper, you just feed light into this photonic crystal cavity. You detune now with respect to your cavity resonance to lower frequencies. And what you can see is that you can nicely go from approximately 100 quanta down to less than one quantum of energy. Again, you can do many things. Already back in 2009, we demonstrated that you can reach the strong coupling regime. Then there are many ideas how to use that for quantum information processing, and so on. The interesting part is, here's an overview of current optomechanical systems that are being pursued at the moment. The intriguing aspect of this slide is the mass range. Look at that. The different systems that are now being controlled by the very same physical principles. So just mechanical motion affecting optical cavity and therefore inducing radiation pressure effects and then enabling quantum optomechanical interactions span the whole range from something like, this is a cloud of ultra-cold atoms, so 10 to the minus 20 kilograms up to on the order of kilograms. Right? Very same principles, almost 20 orders of magnitude in mass. And I find that really intriguing because that means now, if you start doing experiments where mass plays a role, you have a possibility of really covering a large parameter regime and many different physical implementations. Right? So this is, for me, one of the most intriguing aspects of this whole field of putting mechanical systems in the quantum regime, that you have access to this incredibly large span of masses. And this is the rest of my talk is now going to be about what we can do with that. So here is one possibility. I already posed the question in one way. Here is another way of posing the question. Eventually, we feel uneasy about this possibility of having a superposition of a cat being dead or alive because we have basically a observation that we make every day. We only observe cats that are either dead or alive. This is just a matter of fact. No one of us has ever seen yet a cat in a superposition. And because of that fact, of course, we may ask, well, so who killed the cat? Okay, so who actually is responsible for us finding the cat always in just one specific state and not in a superposition state? And there are a couple of possible answers. One is, well, this is just within standard quantum physics. Standard quantum physics tells you if your isolated quantum system couples to another quantum system, which you cannot control so well, and which you maybe cannot also look at, which essentially means, from a quantum physics point of view, you trace out this other system that where your quantum system couples to, suddenly you don't see any quantum features anymore because your system gets entangled with the environment. And what you really would have to do in order to see quantum features would be to measure each and every particle your quantum system has gotten entangled to. And normally you can't do that. You need to throw away a couple of particles and you don't see any quantum properties anymore. Although, in principle, fundamentally, there still would be some. Okay, and this is decoherence. So decoherence doesn't really solve the problem why fundamentally there could be only one of the two. But it just tells you, well, maybe fundamentally there is never either one of the two. Okay, it's just that when we look at it, we just see one of the two. But fundamentally, our reality is strange. This is the one. The other one, well, it's new physics, okay? Something is going to happen when we go to cats, Okay, there is going to be a, I don't know, cat interaction, whatever, some cat force that we have not yet discovered. When we do such an experiment with cats, then there will be a new term in the Schrödinger equation. Okay, and we haven't seen that yet because we haven't done the experiment yet. Okay, so let's try to do the experiment. So here's one other example. I apologize for this writing here. This is messed up. So possible that there are possibilities that are being discussed for this new physics is Penrose is a very famous example. Sir Roger Penrose proposed some time ago that gravity could play a dominant role and actually be responsible for such a so-called state collapse, for the fact that a quantum system, once it's large enough, massive enough, will only be found in one specific state and never, even in principle, in a superposition. And there, there are different theories, experimental proposals. Actually, this was by the Baumeister group. There was a related proposal by Keith's group. So the question is, can we perform experiments that would be able to test such theories? In the end, I now skip a little bit because we are too late. So in the end, the question is, can we, by building up such experiments, enter a regime where such alternative theories, new theories, would make predictions that would deviate significantly from the predictions of quantum theory? Okay. One possibility is, I just need to show you that, sorry. it's too nice not to show it. Recently, there has been a beautiful experiment by Andrew Cleland and John Martinez, who basically created a superposition state of such a huge system, micrometer scale, aluminum nitride, piezo. The point is, so the mass is huge of this thing, okay, so there was like 10 to the 13 atoms, and if you calculate the distance of the superposition state, okay, so now you have two possible states of your system that you put in a superposition, and the question is now, what is the distance between the two? And the distance in this experiment was in the order of 10 to the minus 16 meter. Okay, so you have created a superposition of this supermassive system, but the distance is on the order of 10 to the minus 16 meter. So that's like 10 to the minus 10 times the diameter or the physical extension of the system. Okay, there are other experiments, of course, in the world. There are like this beautiful matter wave interference experiments by the group of Markus Arndt, also in Vienna. They have demonstrated interference with 430 atoms. Much less atoms, but the separation in the superposition was on the order of 100 nanometer, which is 50 times the diameter of the molecule. So it's really like the molecule being here and being, well, you can 50 times. I'm not allowed to leave the microphone because then you won't hear me. So take an atom interferometer, right? One atom, and the separation is on the order of a centimeter. Right? You can build a neutron interferometer with a centimeter arm length difference, which is 10 to the 13 times the diameter. So it seems that going to larger systems, we have to sacrifice the position, the separation, so the macroscopic distinctness between our two states. So the question is now, can we come up with an experiment where we can really separate the center of mass macroscopically? Okay. And there are a couple of proposals. I just browse very briefly through that. The main idea is use the ideas of quantum optomechanics that I just told you about. Take a levitating object, a sphere, trap it optically or trap it magnetically, and put a cavity around it. And then you have a mechanically moving object. It couples dispersively to the cavity, and you can play the very same tricks. You pump now the cavity, detuned, and you can do everything. You can cool it to the quantum ground state, you can put it in superposition states, and so on and so on. Okay? So you do that, and then you cool to the ground state, and then you let it fall. You switch everything off, and you let it fall. The wave function expands, and then you put some type of block. Okay? You make a double slit experiment with this huge wave function. So you do the double slit experiment, let's say you put this block here, and then conditioned on not seeing a particle here, your wave function will then look like that. So you have now prepared a macroscopic superposition between a massive particle, this is like 50 nanometers or so, I think, being here and there. And the separation here, this delta x, is on the order of 2 times the radius, so approximately the diameter of our sphere. Okay? So this would be the idea. If you put in the numbers, of course, this is very challenging. If you go to like 50 or 100 nanometers, the fall times that are involved here, they reach the order of 1/10 seconds or so that is required to actually re-interfere the wave function and then to observe interference fringes. The nice thing about it, so the 100 seconds is the challenging part. The interesting part is if you now plot, if you now calculate the decoherence rates of this superposition as a function of the radius of your sphere, you see that quantum theory is the blue one, scales quadratically. Why does it go up with radius? Well, because you have some background gas. Okay, and it's just the cross scattering, it's just a cross section of the scattering of the background gas scales with the area of the particle. Yeah? At the same time, you have these other alternative theories. Penrose, Carly Hasi, Girardi, Rimini, Weber, Pearl. I didn't have time to tell you about those, but these are other alternative theories. And you see, once you hit a certain size limit, you see that the decoherence rates that are predicted by those alternative theories overcome quantum theory, the decoherence predictions of quantum theory. So we have now a way, in principle, to test for those theories, to falsify those theories. The challenge, as I said once more, is you need these extremely long fall times once you involve this large massive particles. How can you realize that? And that brings me back to the beginning. One possibility is go to space. Okay, 100 seconds of fall time, well, you need to go to a microgravity environment. And one idea would actually be, I put LISA here deliberately, because the amazing thing about LISA is that that the planned optical technology that would be used for LISA is essentially all what you would need for such an experiment. You need a little cavity, you need a medium power laser in order to trap your bead, and you need an environment that, well, of course, that is somehow shielded. But you need a relatively simple optical setup and then some, well, well-developed techniques to trap those particles and so on. But I think the basic optics that you need would all readily be available if we would have that. So one way to go is, this is the so-called LISA Pathfinder. So there is actually now an example that a Pathfinder is good for something, because the Pathfinder actually is a test balloon for LISA. And it, you see, this is actually a thing that is being developed. It's supposed to test the basic principles of LISA in one experiment. There are two corner cubes, and you interferometrically essentially measure the stability of these two corner cubes. Point being, so this is how it looks like then. So if the corner cubes here, the full optics. But the main point being that the optical parts are all there. So this is actually bonded optics. Okay. So very stable. You can have, this is a full interferometer that is on there. You can add cavities if you want, and all of that exists. And we are right now actually collaborating with Astrium to do a little test bonded interferometer to trap such spheres. Recently, together with colleagues from Astrium, Rainer, Keith and I suggested a sort of space mission where we just use the LISA configuration. So this is the LTP, this is all LTP, the LISA technology package, the Pathfinder, and we just modify slightly the optical bench. And then there's a full mission proposal that you find on the archive, how you could use that to actually create those macroscopic superposition states. The experiment, what is the TLR, right? TRL, what is the technological readiness level? Well, close to, well, we have lasers that also fly, so. But here's the experiment. So that's the status of the experiment. So we, you see, what we want to have is we want to trap particles in a cavity. So here's our cavity. You see here a whole string of particles that is trapped inside the cavity, inside the cavity field. We add a dipole trap that is orthogonal to the cavity, and therefore we can actually single out individual ones. So what you have here is we have here a single silica bead of 250 nanometers trapped inside the cavity, levitating at around 4 millibar right now. And what you see here is actually, if you now scan the laser over the cavity frequency, you can see that actually there are motional side bands that are induced due to the motion of the bead on this laser beam. Okay, so that means we really do have already optomechanical coupling. So the bead really dispersively couples to the mechanical motion. So these are the first steps. Of course, this doesn't fly yet, but I think it's pretty clear in which direction this has to go. And we also have some programs together with ESA to develop that into to simply increase the TRL. Another possibility, that's something we are looking in right now together with Ray Chow and also with Keith's group, is can we magnetically levitate instead of optically levitating? And there are some ideas. I don't bore you with the details. Main point is you levitate a superconducting sphere, and instead of having optical cavities, you just have two LC circuits. The mechanical motion of the sphere, because of the Meissner effect, modulates the mutual inductance between these two coils. If you drive that coil, and if the drive is off resonant with the pickup coil, you have again the very same anti-Stokes, resonantly enhanced, the Stokes or anti-Stokes scattering phenomena. And you can then magnetomechanically modify the sphere. So right now we're fooling around with centimeter-sized LED spheres. This is a very fun experiment. Okay, I'm basically should come to an end. I just so here this is the last part that I wanted to tell you about. I won't tell you any details. I just give you one example. Okay, this is I beg for this one extra, not two extra. Let's see. So the main point about gravity, there are many, many beautiful experiments where gravity is combined with quantum physics. They all have in common right now that gravity is simply treated in the strict Newtonian limit, flat space-time. So gravity, the gravitational field simply acts as an additional field that you can simply add as a potential to your Hamiltonian, and therefore you get some nice additional phases to your wave function, and you can have these beautiful gravitationally induced interference fringes. This is the very first experiment, the seminal COW experiment, COW, of Kalela, Oberhauser, and Werner. Later on, of course, related all these atomic interferometer gradiometers measuring gravity gradients. There are also examples of gravitationally bound states of neutrons and so on, but they all have in common that this is the underlying, flat spacetime is the underlying physical principle. Now, you could think, well, what? So there are basically two questions, right? So can gravity be quantized? Oh, there's one question. Can gravity be quantized? And two possible answers, yes or no. Well, it could be that it can fundamentally not be quantized. Okay? If this is the case, then you need some way to marry a non-quantum field theory with a quantum field theory. And there are some ideas, for example, that you just put expectation values for all the energy stress tensors instead of operators, and then what you end up with are some very strange effects. Namely, for example, this is the so-called Schrödinger Newton equation that Dioshi has put forward in 84 and has also been discussed in other contexts. You see this, you, as a consequence of this classical treatment of gravity, you add a non-linear term to the Schrödinger equation. This is a non-local, non-linear term added to the Schrödinger equation. The meaning is sort of a self-gravitation of the wave packet. Okay? And what that results in is, if your wave function wants to spread, because of this gravitational self-interaction, you get a confinement and you end up in some solitonic states. Okay? So this every non-linearity does that normally. So this Gross-Peter-Yevsky that you have also creates soliton in an interacting many-body quantum system. But the question is now, could you test that? Could you test for solitonic behavior of the wave function? Let's put in numbers. So if you take, for example, a mass of 10 to the 10 atomic mass units and a ground state wave function of like 500 nanometers, so these are typically numbers that you get in these macromolecule meta-wave interference experiments. Then the collapse time, which is essentially the time it takes for the wave packet to disperse and due to gravitational self-interaction slow down and stop, right? Or then come back and oscillate a little bit. is on the order of 30,000 seconds. Well, so you could now say either, well, that's a space experiment, right? Or you can say forget it. So it's either way, it's difficult. But if you just slightly change the mass by a couple of orders of magnitude, like 10 to the 12 atomic mass units, and take instead of 500 nanometers a ground state extension of 500 femtometers, then suddenly this collapse time reduces to a few microseconds. Okay? Well, if you think about it, turns out if you take a sphere of, let's say, 400 nanometer radius, and you trap it in an optical magnetic potential at a frequency of a megahertz, 500 femtometer is exactly the spread of the wave function that you get. Okay? So here you have another motivation, having these trapped spheres in a ground state. Here could be a chance, but just by looking at the free dispersion, so forget about the double slit that I proposed before, just the free evolution of the wave function of such a massive particle could give you some bounds on these nonlinearities of the Schrödinger-Newton equation. Yeah, I find that quite interesting. Then there's some other stuff that we did. I don't have time. Ask me if you want to know about it. We proposed some possible experiment to test quantum gravity. I don't talk about that. I just show you an ultimate experiment, a possible one, entanglement by gravity. Maybe we can do that. That's actually an experiment that has been put forward by Feynman in 57 at a gravity conference in Chapel Hill. So the idea is, let's assume, so this is actually Feynman, let's assume we have some device, like Stern-Gerlach, and some device that coherently interacts here, such that you put the ball in a superposition, this massive ball, in a superposition of up and down. Okay? And then you take a second ball and gravitationally couple to this ball. What happens is, due to the gravitational interaction, you start to create an entangled state. Okay? So what does Feynman say? Well, he says many things, okay, but I don't bore you with the details. The point is, in the end, says, aside from that possibility, if you believe in quantum mechanics up to any level, then you have to believe in gravitational quantization in order to describe this experiment. Okay? This is the point that he wants to drive home. The argument that he has is sort of in order to describe that, you have to involve the notion that the field, the gravitational field, actually has to have an amplitude, a probability amplitude, for interacting with the ball up and interacting with the ball down. And that is a notion that you can only have in connection with a quantum theory of gravity, or with a quantum theory of such a field. There's a huge discussion about that, how correct that is, but I think it's a very nice, it could be a very nice implicit test of the possibility to quantize gravity. Again, doing that would require, if you put the number, put the numbers here, a few hundred nanometers of the sphere, again, you would need on the order of several seconds, tens of seconds, to actually create an entangled state, which again would be compatible with such a possible space experiment I was talking about before. Okay, I come to an end. I'm sorry I haven't talked at all about these many beautiful proposals for cold atoms in space. There's really there's a myriad of other possible experiments for space. There simply wasn't time. Here's just one nice example. So here's a cold atom experiment. I mean, cold atom is even much more difficult than photons, right? A photon source. Photon source is small to begin with, but cold atom experiment, I mean, this is huge. Okay, I mean, this is like 2 meter scale here, right? But if you look what these guys, for example, I pick here the Qantas collaboration that tried to put such a cold atom experiment in space. The whole laser system, which in old days really used up 2 optical tables, they managed now to put into this 30 by 30 centimeter size thing here. It's just amazing. And then the whole trap, the mod and so on, they just put here, this is like 4 centimeters or so, right? Fiber couple, blah, blah. They couple that to the laser system, they put it into this thing, and they let it fall from a drop tower and just do beautiful cold atom experiments over 9 seconds. So this is these are amazing experiments, and they also have the goal, of course, to fly eventually. Mark Kasevich also is following up on putting atom interferometers in space, and many others. So I would like to actually sum up. So I just wanted to show you once more. So everything I told you about now, all these ideas and maybe what is the relation to possible space experiments, are exactly the things that we are right now discussing in the Keck workshop over there. And many of the questions that I have addressed today, we already discussed the last 3 days, and many of the things that I left out are being discussed the whole week. So I just wanted to point it out one more time. This is really a simply fantastic opportunity. And again, what I want to emphasize is these developments towards space, really I see them as enabling future technologies for new experiments on the foundations of quantum physics. This is what I'm really interested in, and I really think every step that we take in order to make such experiments go will help us to come up with new experiments and really gain in the long term new insights in the nature of physics. And with this, I would like to conclude. I would like to thank all my many collaborators around the world who really share their great wisdom with me and have the patience to discuss with me. And this is my group in Vienna. We have a couple of programs. Actually, I couldn't tell you at all about low noise coatings that we do. We have actually a collaboration here with the LIGO guys to look if these low noise coatings could be helpful for LIGO. We have this quantum gravity test that I didn't have time to talk about. The levitated resonators I told you about. There's a whole team. We're collaborating here with Markus Andre, Chao, Keith Schwab, with Astrium, and so on. And of course, there are the quantum information interfaces, where we have a long-standing collaboration now with the Painter Group and with other theory groups from Europe. With this, I would like to thank you very much once again for having me and for your attention. Yeah, it's just the accent, right?
Yeah. There's substance. There's a lot of substance.
So I'll be back.
Let's have some questions. Come on, guys.
Where's the food?
Anybody? Come on. There you go.
What's your idea to test quantum gravity?
Yeah, I guess you were all just waiting for that part, right? I didn't put it in deliberately because, yeah. Okay, here's the idea. So, the motivation is the following. The motivation is, if there exists a fundamental length scale, and actually if you look into those theories of quantum gravity, many of those have to or just do assume a minimum length scale. This could be at the lower scale, the Planck length, but this could also be something like 10 to the something times the Planck length. If you believe that this is the case, then you have a problem with the Heisenberg uncertainty relation because you cannot reduce your minimum position uncertainty below this minimum length scale. In order to avoid this complication, there are several people out of the quantum gravity theory community who started to propose modifications to the Heisenberg uncertainty relation. Okay? These are modifications that all the whole quantum theoretical framework is maintained fully, so which means you do find some transformation under which in a new set of coordinates you have again the regular Heisenberg uncertainty, but with the old coordinates you have this modification. Question is, can one test that? If it's really out there, can one test that? Well, obviously, you cannot test it by just directly trying to measure the uncertainty because the Planck length is on the order of 10 to the minus 35 meter, and our best position resolution is like 17 orders of magnitude away from there. So don't even think about it. So instead of measuring the dynamics of a system, can we do something else? And here's the idea. The idea is, in quantum theory, we have the possibility of just having some operations that we can perform on a system. What if we are able to perform on a massive system this operation, which is a displacement actually it's a placement in X, so a displacement operator with P, with minus X, with minus P, and with X. So what if we could do that? And this is not a continuous thing. Each of this can be just a very point-like interaction. Okay, so forget about dynamics. This is a very important point. Okay? So you just have four instantaneous interactions at different times. And these interactions here, these four displacements, they just add up to this overall interaction. And you just use your Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff relations, blah, 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 to come to this interaction. So it turns out, if you were able to have those four point-like interactions, neglecting all the dynamics, you end up in something that contains the commutator. Okay? Now, if you were to push your mechanical system by a pulse of light, and if you couple this mechanical system to a cavity, you have this optomechanical situation again, and therefore each pulse has an optomechanical coupling. And it turns out that this allows you to actually realize exactly this sort of displacements. And instead of now measuring the mechanical system, you measure the optical system after the operation. Okay? If you push it around, I mean, what this does is in phase space, it just makes a closed loop. And if you do that with light, so you have an ancilla that pushes it around. During the pushing around, the systems are entangled, the light and the mechanics. And after you have concluded the full turn, they are disentangled again. You can measure the light. And it turns out, if you just calculate how the light is changed after the interaction with the mechanical system, that also the light, so just the mean value here of the field, that also the light actually carries the commutator's information. So it simply means because of the optomechanical interaction, you can imprint the commutator onto your light field. So just by measuring essentially the phase rotation of your light, you get a measure of the commutator. Okay? And then we asked, well, how precise can you actually measure that? So that was our question. So obviously this is a complicated way of measuring I, but the question is how accurately can you measure that? And then it turns out if you do the numbers, you can measure it to such an extent that if there were a modification to the commutator, this modification would result in an additional phase shift. And if you choose your numbers carefully enough, you should be able to resolve this additional phase shift. So this additional phase shift now depends on, where did we put that here? This additional phase shift, this depends now, depending on now which modification you choose, depends on the mass of the system, depends on the finesse and so on, the photon number, right? And we have chosen here parameters. We found a set of parameters that if we were able to do the experiment with this set of parameters, a null result, so not observing any additional phase shift, would mean that we have provided an upper bound of this possible modifications on the order of the Planck length. Okay? That is the message. Now there are questions.
Okay, so, but how this proposal of yours depends on the initial state of the oscillator?
Mm. Yeah, very much. So we assumed. Oh, sorry. So the question was, how much does this whole scheme depend on the initial state of the oscillator? We have simply assumed Gaussian state to start with. Let's say a thermal state with an occupation of like 30 quanta or so. Okay, and we didn't try out any exotic states. So we tried to keep the requirements as simple as possible, just thermal state, and you need to cool it down a little bit because if your state is too hot, then you cannot guarantee that that you end up in the same point any longer. So this is actually a very important requirement, and you end up in close to the same point. This is where this is an important error margin. But it turns out 30 quanta so are sufficient.
If it is addressable by a superposition of those micro quanti states, so that, that while you may not be able to resolve it, you still have a superposition with a probability distribution over the possible positions.
So essentially, the question is there a relation between the Planck length modifications and the possibility to observe still superpositions of a massive system? Actually, I think that so I don't know the answer. First of all, I would say, since this is a framework of a quantum theory of gravity, there should not be any intrinsic decoherence mechanism for my superposition. Okay, this is what my suspicion would be. If it really works, then but you should be able to collect an additional phase somehow, right? Because you have a coordinate transformation and so on. So this is that's a good question. Thanks.
One more short question. Okay, why don't we do this? If anybody else wants to ask a question, then come on down. But before we go, Barris has something for Markus.
Yay. All right.
All right.
Need the mic?
Step over. Yeah, I'll plug it for a few seconds. So I recognize we've run a little bit over, so I'm not going to keep you too long. But I first want to thank you all for coming. I hope you found this lecture as entertaining and enlightening as I did. And I want to thank Markus for taking both the time and the effort to actually put together this very nice talk. Now, as he very implicitly pleaded for help at the end of his talk, we've been holding him hostage at the Keck Institute for Space Studies. Studies. I think it's about this location. I practiced it 10 times now. Yes, we've been holding him hostage since the beginning of the week, and we plan to do so for the rest of the week. So Markus really hasn't had the time to explore the beautiful Caltech campus and look at its very interesting architecture. And so in the true spirit of being scholarly, we decided we would give him a book which explains all about this architecture and let him peruse it in his own leisure time. And so it's my great pleasure to give Markus this little gift from us, from the Keck Institute, to...
Thank you so much.